The French Chef is made possible by a grant from Safeway Stores.
Everybody loves the taste of caramel. This is caramel syrup. I'm going to line a mold with it. And then we're going to cook a lovely French custard in the mold. And when we unmold it, it'll be covered by a beautiful brown caramel coating. We're doing caramel desserts today on The French Chef. Welcome to The French Chef. I'm Julia Child. Today we're going to do two awfully nice caramel desserts. One is a French custard called crème renversée au caramel, and the other one is an apple custard, and both of them are baked in a mold or a dish like this, and then when they're done, they're unmolded. And they're easy to do and delicious to eat, and I think you'll enjoy both of them very much. Now, caramel is, we might as well start right in on our subject, is just a thick brown syrup that is syrupy when it's warm, and then as soon as it cools, it gets hard and brittle like that. You see, that's just brittle. And when you line a mold with caramel like this and then bake something in it, when you unmold it, there's a caramel coating that's left on the top of it. So we shall get right to the making of our caramel. And all caramel is just sugar that's cooked until it is a dark brown. And you just use ordinary granulated sugar. And I'm going to use half a cup of sugar. And then you always want to have a little bit of water in with it, about a third the amount of water. So we have, if you have a cup of sugar, you'd use a third of a cup of water. So I'll use, with a half a cup of sugar, about 2.5 tablespoons of water. And then you cook it in some kind of a heavy pan. This one that I have here is a French sugar cooking pan. It's made out of unlined copper, but you can use any kind of a heavy pan. The syrup that I started out with, this is just a half-heavy aluminum pan. What you want, because the caramel gets terribly hot as it cooks, so that you have to have something that won't collapse or blow up. And I think if you don't have the copper pan, use heavy aluminum. And the first part of it is that you have to be careful of is when you have your sugar and your water in the pan, and you have to, before the sugar begins to boil and begin to go through its various stages of sugar cooking, you want to swirl the pan like this to make sure that the sugar and water have melted. If you don't do that, you'll find that the sugar will often crystallize, and then rather than having a smooth, lovely syrup, you'll have sort of a motley, sort of crystallized stuff that won't harden up. So until your sugar comes up to the boil, just swirl the pan like that. You see, I'm just holding my hand on it and then just swirling it over the heat. And if you can see now, the sugar has almost melted. You can tell when it's melted when the liquid just suddenly turns clear. It's now a little bit cloudy. Now it's beginning to boil, and the sugar has melted in it. And then as soon as it's really boiling frankly and has that clear look, then you can go off and do something else, but you want to keep fairly close to it, because after it's boiled for a little while, then, as you'll notice now, the bubbles are fairly large, but they aren't sort of thick, syrupy bubbles. But as soon as you see the bubbles begin to look syrupy, you want to watch out. And so while that's cooking a little bit more, we will discuss the kind of molds that you can use. I'm using these French Charlotte molds. This is an iron which has been coated with tin, and it has little ears on it which make it very convenient to lift up. But for this kind of a dessert, you can cook in any kind of a cylindrical dish. This is the typical French souffle mold made out of fireproof porcelain, and that's a very nice one to cook in. Or this is just a plain, ordinary aluminum pan with straight sides, and here is a fireproof glass. Or you can use an oval shape if you don't want to use the round one. But as long as the sides are fairly straight so that you can unmold your desserts, you don't have any trouble. Now we'll take another look at our sugar. And if you've ever done any candy cooking, you know that sugar goes through various stages of boiling. There's the thread stage and the soft ball and the hard ball and the crack. And then finally, there is caramel. And you can tell, you can use a candy thermometer like that, but it's a good idea to see how, see with your naked eye how the sugar looks. So I'm going to take a spoon and just dip it in. You can see that's coating the spoon fairly heavily, so it shows that most of the water is boiled out. And then you can dip your hand into a glass of water and pull it off. And you see that's forming a heavy thread. That's already gone by the thread stage. And then, when it's gone by that stage, you'll probably hit the soft ball. And then you'll just drop some sugar into your water. Now, this has even gone beyond the soft ball now, because you'll notice when I pick it up, well, that's almost the hard ball. When you pick up a little piece like that, and it will form a ball, that would be a fairly hard ball. And then the next stage is the crack. And that is when you put the sugar into the water, you can see that it forms a rather hard lines. And then when you pick it out of the water, it's brittle. And that is brittle. Now you can see you can break those pieces of sugar between your fingers. And then when you get to that stage, you've practically got it. And that's when you want to begin looking carefully. And if you'll notice the bubbles now, you will see that they do have that syrupy look to them. And at this stage, then you want to stay right near it and keep swirling your pan a little bit, because pretty soon it's going to turn into caramel. And it's convenient having this wooden handle, so you can just shake it around. That's not quite beginning to turn yet. Now, caramel is something that you can use for other things than desserts. If you happen to see our duck with orange recipe, it was a roast duck with orange sauce. We made a sweet and sour caramel, which gave a nice brown color to the sauce. And that was just after the sugar had turned to caramel. Then we put in some vinegar and cooked that down so that you wouldn't have this sauce sweet. And then we put our meat stock in it, and it turned a lovely brown. A lot of the Chinese sweet and sour dishes are made that way. And also, if you're making a soup and you want to darken that up, you can make caramel. After the caramel is made, then you'd pour in water and then dissolve all the caramel and then put that into your soup, and you have a nice dark color. Now, it's just beginning at this point to turn an amber color. And if you're using quite a heavy pot, you want to be very careful to take it off just before it's done. And it's a good idea, if you have a heavy pot like the one we were using at the beginning, to have a basin of water handy. And as soon as it's gotten almost to the color you want, you take it off and plunge the bottom of the bowl into the cold water, because you don't want it to burn black. If you can see now, this is an amber color, and it can go just a little bit more. It's beginning to smoke, but we don't want to go much beyond this. So now when it's just at the stage you want, you pour it right into your mold. And then you just turn the mold in all directions. And then you wait until the caramel stops moving, and then you reverse it over a plate. I'm very often using a porcelain mold. If it's cold weather, I heat the porcelain a little bit. Otherwise, the caramel gets hard too quickly. Now, as you can see how that's working now, and that's just about stopped going. So you just reverse it over a plate and put it aside, and you're all ready to go. And now we have our caramel custard. As you're going to see, this is very quick to do. We're going to put this caramel custard into a 6-cup mold, and we want 5 whole eggs. There are 2. 4. And there's 5 whole eggs. And then we want 4 egg yolks. You always, if you're going to unmold a dessert, you have to have a little more more egg whites than yolks. We've got 4 egg yolks there. And then we have 3¾ cups of hot milk. And if the when the milk is hot, you often see there's this little skin on top of it, and you just take that off. And then we're also going to have 3/4 of a cup of granulated sugar. So you beat up your eggs and just beat the 3/4 of a cup of sugar in. And when you have whole eggs, you don't have to worry about beating the sugar in gradually, because the egg white acts sort of protects the egg yolks. The egg yolks are the delicate members of the family. And if you had just egg yolks and that was all, you'd beat your sugar in gradually. So this just has to be thoroughly mixed up and beat it until it's just a little bit foamy. And then we're going to have a vanilla flavoring. And what you can do, if you have a vanilla bean, these you can buy anywhere, they look like that, you'd heat your milk and then you'd put the vanilla bean in and put a cover on the pan and just let it steep for about 20 minutes. And if you don't have a vanilla bean, you'd use about 2 teaspoons of a good brand of vanilla extract. And then you very gradually beat the milk into the eggs. And this is what you always want to do if you're adding a hot liquid into eggs, is that you gradually beat it in. Then you don't give your eggs a shock so that they will suddenly scramble. So that was 3¾ of a cup of milk that I'm beating in. We had 5 whole eggs and 4 egg yolks and 2 teaspoons of vanilla. Then we take our 6-cup mold. This was the mold that we lined at the beginning. And then you always strain your custard mixture into the mold, because there might be sort of little egg particles of egg or something like that, like egg shell or, you know, that little white part in the egg. And so you just strain it in, because you want to have as beautiful and smooth a custard as possible. Now that's all there is to the making of the custard. And then it's ready for baking. And this is going to go into the oven, and it's going to bake in a pan of water. And the important thing when you're baking a custard is that the water should never quite simmer. It should just shiver a little bit. And this is going to go into that pan. And the water should come about half the way up. And I've got the oven at 350, and that'll bake for about 40 minutes. And then, when it's done, it's going to look like this. This one I did this morning. And now you can tell, you see how that is, there's just a little bit of brown on the top of it. And you can tell when it's done by taking a little knife and plunging it right into the center of the custard. And when you take the knife out, there's no custard sticking onto it. If you see little bits of egg and so forth on the custard, then just bake it a little bit longer. But just be sure in the baking that you never let the water actually simmer. And now to unmold it, you have to let it settle after it's cooked, because if you tried to unmold it immediately, it would just collapse entirely on the plate. So if you want to serve it hot, you can serve it either hot, warm, or cold. You let it settle for about around 20 minutes, and then by that time it sort of has gotten itself together and is ready. And then take a knife and just go around the edge of the mold. That just loosens it. And if you've had the custard in the refrigerator, in case you want to serve it chilled, it might be a good idea just before unmolding it just to put it on the heat for just a moment. And then that would loosen the bottom. And then take your serving dish and turn it upside down and then turn the whole thing up and give it a bang. And you can tell when it's come out because you can feel it. There it is. Doesn't that look nice? And you've got that nice brown on the top of it, and then you still have a little caramel syrup. And if you want, you can sprinkle it with a little bit of chopped nuts, like that. And that makes a perfectly delicious dessert. As you see how quickly that assembly was. And now we're going to do an apple dessert. And this one is an apple custard. It's about the same idea. It's baked in a mold, but there's going to be sliced apples, which are baked in the oven, and then just mixed with eggs. And the only sort of arduous part to this is the slicing of the apples. And I think the quickest way to do them is to cut the apples in quarters like that, and then take out the core and then peel. I think if you take sort of a vegetable peeler and have to go around and round the apples and then core them, it just takes forever. And it seems to me that this is a fairly quick way of doing it. And the type of apple you should use is one that has a good flavor and is nice and crisp. I'm using Macintosh eating apples. I just happen to like them. But you don't want one of those punky apples that doesn't have any crispness to it. I wish we had more types of apples in this country. In France, they always use an apple called the Reinette, or the Little Queen, and that's the main cooking apple. If you run into any little brown spots, just cut them all out. Then get all your apples peeled, and then use this same system that we have done with everything else. Just take your knife and our usual knife grip and just go quank, quank like that. See, that is very quickly done. If you hold it like this, that just takes a long time. We're going to have 12 cups or 3 quarts of apples for this, and that just takes for ages. But if you just do it this way, you see how quickly done that is. Now, this knife work, it's just something you'll have to practice. And every time, sort of welcome recipes that have you slice and cut. Because by doing that, you will find that you just suddenly are able to cut quickly. And then when you've gotten 12 cups of apples, put them in a roasting pan like this and mix them with a big spatula with 2 tablespoons of lemon juice and a teaspoon of cinnamon and about 1/2 cup of sugar, and then 1/2 cup of melted butter, and just mix them all up like that and put them in the oven and bake them for about 20 minutes or so. And then after 20 minutes or so, they come out looking like this. See, they've just been cooked, and they're cooked through, but they still have their slice shape. And then for the custard mixture, you take the grated rind of 1 lemon. I think these flat graters are very useful. And grate the lemon in. Then we're going to have 4 eggs, whole eggs. 2. This is going to go into a 2-quart mold. There's 4, and then 1 egg white. No, I've got a little bit of shell in there. I did that a little too fast. And then we're going to put in a little flavoring if you like. I think rum and apple is very nice. And I'm going to put in 2 tablespoons of dark rum. And then you just beat that up. If you don't like rum or liquor, you can put in some vanilla. You don't have to put anything in. And that's just beaten up so it's well mixed. And then the apples are folded in. I'm going to save out a few. I may not need all of that. A few that drop. Those are just folded in like that. And then we have our caramel-lined mold. Look at that big piece of caramel that just stuck out there. And then the apples go right in. I think I turned that mold over a little bit too fast because the bottom of it didn't quite get the caramel out, but that won't make any difference. It would be prettier if I had waited a little longer. And then if the mold isn't quite filled, put in more apples. And then just stir it up. You see, with this dessert, once you have your apples done, there isn't much else to it. And then you don't want to fill it too full because it's going to swell up to there as it cooks. And then this, again, is cooked in the oven, at the same oven, about 350. And this will take about an hour and a half to cook. And you can tell when it's done because it will, just when you just take it out of the oven, it'll probably be up to there. But you'll see a very slight line of shrinkage there. And then you can also put a little knife in like that. And if it comes out clean, that again is done. And this also can be served hot or cold. It doesn't make any difference. And we unmold it exactly the same way. Run a knife around the edge. And also remember, again, if you have put it in the fridge and it's cold, that you might just heat up the bottom a little bit, and then you'll be sure that it won't stick. And then you turn that upside down. And there you are. And that, you can serve with it one of those French custard sauces or cream. Or if you wanted to, you could have some more of your cooked apples and serve them with it. And I'm going to now show you something else that you can serve with it, which is a nut brittle. And this is something else that you can make with your caramel. There, I'll get this out of the way. And all of this is caramel and nuts, and it comes out just like a peanut brittle, like that. And it's delicious to eat. And also, if you can pound it all up and use it as a topping. Now I've got some more caramel in here, and I'm going to have to heat it up a bit. And you see how terribly easy this is to do and fun. And you can, it's very good on ice cream, or if you're making like a Bavarian cream, you can make it with this nut brittle. In French, this is called pralin or praline. Now this, I've got, if you've made extra caramel, as I have, you have to keep it warm. I've kept it on low, but that wasn't quite warm enough. But if it's too hot, then it will burn. But if you, as long as you keep it so that it hasn't completely congealed, you can always heat it up again. Well, that's beginning to heat up. And I'm going to use with this just some chopped almonds. And these are almonds with their shell on, and it's a good idea when you're making this kind of a brittle to dry them out in the oven until they're just lightly brown so that they don't have any too much moisture in them, because you want the brittle to be brittle. And if the nuts have too much moisture in them, that can sometimes soften the brittle so it won't harden up. Now I'm going to put my nuts in a smaller pan. Then pour the caramel on. You can do it either way. And the proportions don't make very much difference. It's about half and half I'm using. But if you can have more or less nuts, then you just stir it all up. I think we'll have to have a little more caramel in. You just want to get the nuts and the caramel well mixed, but you're not cooking it again. And then you put it on a plate and let it cool off. If I'd had the caramel a little softer, it would have spread out a little bit more. There. And then after that's cooled off, that'll be about, 20 or 30 minutes. It becomes hard and brittle like that. Then you can pound it with a mallet in a bowl, or you can put it through a mixer. And see, that's really nice and brittle, but you may find if you're doing it on a damp day that that it'll get sort of, it'll lose its brittleness a little bit and get sticky, but there isn't much of anything you can do in that case except just eat it up. And then after you've ground it up, it looks like this. And you can keep it in a covered jar, and it'll keep for weeks and weeks. And I'm just going to put a little bit of this on my apple custard because I think it'll be very nice. Oh, no, that's another thing with the brittle that you can use. Do you remember the pastry cream we made way back when we did some fruit tarts? Well, if you make the pastry cream and then you fold some beaten egg whites in along with some of this nut brittle, you have a perfectly delicious dessert. And you can also soak some lady fingers or sponge cake, little pieces of it, in rum or in orange juice, and put that down in the bottom of a dessert bowl, and then put this pastry cream with the nut brittle on top, and it makes a very nice quick dessert. So I think now we're about ready to see how our desserts look on the table. Now those were really quick to do. Of course, the cooking is a little bit longer. We have here our apple custard, and I'm going to serve you some so you'll see how it looks. See, that's a nice delicate thing, practically a souffle. And you can see the apple slices there. You can make it with apple sauce, but I like it better this way. Then you can put a little bit of heavy cream or custard sauce on it. And then you have your nice caramel taste. And then we have our crème renversée, our caramel custard. I just love this dessert. It's so sort of delicate. It's almost heart-rending, I think. As you can see why you want to cook it slowly, just simmering, not quite simmering water, because if the water's too hot and it's frankly bubbling, you won't have this lovely silken, velvety look to your custard. You'll have sort of a little granular appearance. And that's really about all that you need to know in the way of cooking the custard. Just remember to watch your heat and always cook it in a pan of water. And then you won't have any trouble with it. And remember about the testing of it. Use the knife test. Just plunge the knife in, and when you draw it out, it's perfectly clean. So everybody loves custard, and everybody will love you if you serve them one of these delicious caramel desserts. That's all for today on The French Chef. This is Julia Child. Bon appétit.
Julia Child is co-author of the book Mastering the Art of French Cooking. Furniture and accessories, courtesy of Design Research Incorporated. French Chef is made possible by a grant from Safeway Stores.